إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، indeed we praise Allah, the Most High, and we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts blessings in this gathering, and we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it a source of good for all that attend, from those of you who are from the believers and have taken upon yourself belief, and from those of you who are looking into Islam or who are interested in becoming further acquainted with this most beautiful and illustrious deen. Indeed, as we mentioned week after week and time again concerning the deen and concerning this gathering and the likes of this gathering, we mentioned that this gathering was put together and was constructed for the purpose of aiding those from amongst the brothers and the sisters who have relatives or who have friends or who have neighbors and intend to enlighten them concerning this religion, the religion of Al-Islam. And indeed the religion of Al-Islam, brothers and sisters, is that religion which without doubt is an extension of the religion that was given to every single one of the messengers, and it is without doubt the call of all of the messengers, the call of La ilaha illallah, the call to worship one God, and the call to mankind that he should turn his attention to that one God, and that that one God and that one creator created them for a purpose. So as we began concerning the sitting, we mentioned that which was known as the Khutbatul Hajj, or that beginning that we mentioned, those Arabic words that we mentioned, is referred to as the Khutbatul Hajj. The Khutbatul Hajj, brothers and sisters, was that sermon that the Messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, used to begin his sermons with, and he used to begin his addresses to the people with. And it is a sermon that is filled with guidance for the people, and it is filled with guidance for those who reflect upon its meanings. Inna alhamdulillah, indeed, all praises for Allah. Nahmaduhu, we praise him. Wa nasta'inuhu, and we seek his aid. ونستغفره, and we seek his forgiveness. Because there is no doubt, brothers and sisters, that the one who understands that Allah is his Lord and his return is to Allah, he will understand that it is a must therefore that he gives praise to Allah and gives thanks to Allah, and likewise that he seeks his aid, because there is no power and no aid except by way of the aid of Allah, and there is no help except the help of Allah. نَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ, and we seek his forgiveness. Because indeed, as we mentioned, if we recognize the fact that all of us were created and all of us that are beings that are going to die, we must recognize by way of that we therefore have to return to Allah and give account for ourselves. And if we have to return to Allah and give account for ourselves, then we should ensure that that account is good. And if we have slipped up along the course of our life and during the path of our life, then it's a must that we make that istighfar, that we seek the forgiveness of our Creator. So here the Messenger, peace and blessings, used to say, وَنَسْتَغْفِرُ, and we seek his forgiveness. Then he would continue after saying, إِنَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُ وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا, and we seek forgiveness and we seek aid, refuge in Allah from the evils of ourselves, from the sayyi'at a'malina, and from the evil consequences of our actions. Because without doubt, brothers and sisters, if anyone finds himself in an evil destination in the hereafter, or in something from evil in this life, then that will be a result without doubt of some evil that has come from himself. That result and that end, that evil end that he has, is without doubt, as we mentioned, as a result of his own actions. So here the Messenger used to guide his nation and is to guide the believers to seeking refuge in the evils of ourselves and in the evils of our and the evil consequences of our evil deeds. مَيَهْدِهِ اللَّهِ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهِ. And here the messenger used to make that statement that was that most important and potent statement, and that was where he used to say مَيَهْدِهِ اللَّهِ, whosoever Allah has guided, and there is none to misguide. وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهِ. And whoever Allah has misguided, then there is none to misguide. And concerning that, there's a question that was posed here. As-salamu alaykum, a friend has asked the question, why does Allah say in the Quran that whoever Allah guides, none can misguide, and whoever Allah misguides, then none can guide? Why will Allah guide His loving, misguide His loving creation? Please elaborate on this critical saying, insha'Allah. So concerning that, we say that there is no doubt that the statement of Allah and His Messenger, that whosoever Allah guides, there is none to misguide, and whosoever Allah misguides, there is none to guide aright, is a statement that is clarified by a number of other ayat, a number of other verses in the Book of Allah. Those other verses in the Book of Allah would clarify that a person's guidance or misguidance is as a product of oneself. As Allah has mentioned in the Quran concerning the Jews, when they went astray, it was their own going astray that led Allah to continue to misguide their hearts. فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. And when they first went astray, then Allah made their hearts go astray. And there are a number of verses in the Book of Allah that would indicate that that misguidance is not a product of Allah misguiding a person without showing him the right way. Rather, it is a product of a person's heart becoming misguided after once being upon right guidance, or after being, or after having the right guidance shown to them, and then they reject that. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases them in that. As Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala likewise has said, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا. And from the people there are those who say that we believe in Allah, آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and we believe in the hereafter, and indeed they do not believe. يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. That indeed they attempt to deceive Allah and those who believe. وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ. But indeed they do not deceive except themselves, but they do not realize. Then Allah continues, في قلوبهم مرض. In their hearts is a sickness. In their hearts is a sickness. That their hearts, because of a sickness that they have in their hearts, after once receiving the correct guidance, and after once understanding what that correct guidance was, and them having that sickness in their hearts, that sickness was seen by Allah, and because of it, because of them acting upon that, and continuing in misguidance and attempting to deceive Allah and deceive the believers, Allah has said, في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا. That indeed in their hearts is a sickness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has increased them in that sickness. So as we find, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, we've mentioned the sitting is to clarify and to bring forward that which we mention in every session as being true knowledge. And that true knowledge, brothers and sisters, is, as we like to mention, for those who respect true knowledge. For those who have a respect for themselves and respect themselves enough to enlighten themselves in regards to certain hidden truths or certain truths that are obscure to many because of that which is being promoted in this time by way of materialism, by that which is being promoted in this time by way of freedom. A freedom which in actuality is a false freedom, because it is a freedom that revolves around democracy, and that freedom necessitates that a person, for him to be free and for him to be considered a person that is from the free world, then his thought must be a democratic thought. And if you attempt to think in a manner that is other than democratic, then you are the person that is looked upon in an evil manner, or a person that goes against the free world. And other than that, then how can this be considered, therefore, brothers and sisters, freedom and free thought, when in actuality it is a thought that is restricted to one having a democratic thought? So we say, brothers and sisters, therefore, that the vast majority of the people are obscure from this, or this this reality is made obscure to them because of that which they surround, that which surrounds them by way of materialism, and that which surrounds them by way of concepts and ideologies which are man-made concepts and ideologies. So we say therefore that the message of Islam, the message of the Muslimin, is to return to the true deen of Allah, to return to the true religion of Allah, and to return to one's true purpose, to return to that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, has created his creation for, and to return to that which every single one of the messengers used to call to. So our call is that, as the messenger, peace and blessings be upon him, has said, the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned that he is the final of all of the messengers, and there is no messenger after the messenger Muhammad. But what is left and what remains is that those who believe in that true message, and those who believe in Allah, and those who believe in that which every single one of the messengers called to, by way of the true deen and by way of tawheed, by way of believing in Allah alone, by way of recognizing the fact that they are creation and I have a purpose, by way of recognizing the fact that they have to die one day and that they are limited beings, by recognizing the fact that, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, that indeed mankind is created weak. When they recognize that, and they recognize the fact that they are people who, as we mentioned, are limited, then they will recognize the fact that without doubt the call of every single one of the messengers was without doubt the true call and the one truth that continues to exist, and that is La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, that there is no Lord worthy of worship but Allah, and that the Messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, is his final final slave and servant and messenger. A message which is simple, but a message, even though it is simple, that is attacked from all angles, a message that is deemed to be a barbaric message, a message that is deemed to be a message that seeks to bring the people away from civilization and bring them into regression, a message that is claimed that it subjects women to oppression, and other than that, from the false claims that are given to the Muslims and put upon al-Islam. So we say therefore that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we mentioned, has created the heavens and the earth, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after creating the heavens and the earth, He created mankind, the first of mankind being Adam, placed him in that earth for the purpose of carrying out a most noble goal, and that is embodied in the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْإِنسَ وَالْجِنَّ وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو قُوَّةٍ مَتِينٍ. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has said that indeed I have not created the jinn or mankind إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except that they worship me. مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ, indeed I do not want from them, from risk, from provision, وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ, and I do not want from them that they should feed, يعني that they should be the ones who are providing. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ, indeed Allah is the one who grants provisions, ذُو قُوَّةٍ مَتِينٍ, the one who is possessing quwwa, might and power. Therefore, brothers and sisters, the message of Al-Islam, as we've mentioned, is a simple one. It is the message of Moses, it is the message of Abraham, it is the message of Isaiah, it is the message of Nuh, Noah, it is the message of every single one of the messengers, a simple message that we mentioned was always fought against by a party of the people who disbelieved in that message. And in this particular time we would say that that which opposes this message, and that which finds this message obnoxious, and that which finds this message an evil message, is the concept of materialism. That concept of which embodies, other than that, with the likes of democracy and other than that, yani that thing which says or calls the people to believing in themselves and following their own desires and believing in concepts that were constructed by man and believing in the fact that you are individuals who are free to think as you wish to think and believe in that which you wish to believe in, a concept that has in it an embodiment of the construction of one's own morals. that morals and morality is something that is upon you. You're free, O mankind, to believe in that which you wish to believe in. You're free to believe or construct for yourselves those morals that you yourselves believe to be correct. So anything that you believe to be correct, and anything that you deem to be something that is upright, then it is up to you to believe that, and no one can fight against you concerning that, and no one can claim that your concepts are incorrect. Everyone is free to believe anything that they wish to believe in. And we say therefore, brothers and sisters, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after creating the heavens and the earth, and creating mankind, and placing in the earth that which mankind needs to exist, and then explaining to mankind that the purpose of his creation is that he worships Allah and that he follows those messengers that he sends, that we say therefore, brothers and sisters, that that is the one true reality that is being made obscure, that is being hidden from the minds of mankind. Therefore, brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has clarified to us and has mentioned to us in an ayah, in a verse in the book of Allah, that should be reflected upon by every single one of us. And that is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَعْلَمُ أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ وَلَهُ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. That know that the life of this world, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, يَعْلَمُ أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ, is play and amusement, and mutual boasting amongst ourselves, and mutual rivalry, and the amounting of wealth and of children. And Allah continues to strike an example. كَمَثَلِ غَيْثٍ أَعْجَبَ الْكُفَّارُ نَبَاتُ. Just like a rain that brings forward growth, that growth brings amusement and brings delight to the tiller, to the farmer. كمثل غيث أعجب الكفار نباته ثم يهيج, and then it begins to wither. فتراه مصفرا, and you see it becoming yellow. ثم يكون حطاما, and then you see it crumbling and drying and decaying. So Allah strives for us an example of the life of this world, that it is nothing but play and amusement, and the mutual gathering of wealth, and the gathering of children, and of things of this world, and pomp and amusement. Then Allah continues, وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ, and in the hereafter is a severe punishment. وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانٌ, and forgiveness from Allah and His good pleasure. And what is the life of this world? Allah finishes the ayah, finishes the verse, and what is the life of this world? إِلَّا مَتَعُ الْغُرُورِ, is what is the life of this world except for a possession, or except for a deceptive possession? What is the life of this world except for amounting possessions and amounting wealth and amounting children? So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, after mentioning the realities of the life of this world, He mentions to us another reality. And that is the reality of the life of another world. The reality of another life. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ, and in the hereafter, وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ, and in the hereafter, in the life after this life, in the life that comes after the life of this world, there is nothing but one of two things. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ, severe punishment. وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ, or مَغْفِرَةٌ, or forgiveness from Allah, وَرِضْوَانٌ, and His good pleasure. وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَعْمُ الْغُرُورِ, and what is the life of this world except for a possession, or a deceptive possession? So here Allah clarifies the reality of the hereafter, and that is that that hereafter is a hereafter that is one of two things. Either it is a hereafter that is a hereafter that is filled with good pleasure for that individual, good pleasure for the person who follows the message of the messengers, and follows that which Allah the Most High has guaranteed, if one follows that, then he will receive good pleasure. Or it is a hereafter of adabun shadeed, of a severe torment, a severe torment for those who follow that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised If one follows it, then he will receive that severe punishment and severe torment. Therefore, brothers and sisters, the messengers, every single one of them, when they came, their message, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, was one of two things. As Allah mentions, رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْدِرِينَ, messengers, مُبَشِّرِينَ, giving glad tidings, وَمُنْدِرِينَ, and warning, giving glad tidings and warning, giving glad tidings of that which will come to those who follow the message, that which will come to those who act upon their true purpose of creation, وَمُنْدِرِينَ, and warning those who follow other than that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed by way of deen or by way of religion, warning those who act upon other than that and leave that alone and throw that behind their backs, warning them of a severe punishment that awaits them. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we say that this deen of Al-Islam, this religion of Al-Islam, is a religion, brothers and sisters, that is without doubt the message of every single one of the messengers, and it is the call of every single one of the righteous. Therefore, brothers and sisters, if that is the case, what is it that the people find, or have, why is it that we find that the people have such a problem with this message? What is it that when a person stands to call to such a simple message, such a beautiful message, a message that is embodied in those truths, and a message that is filled with realities that everyone's soul recognizes, why should that message create and serve as such a problem? Why should it be a message that is received with hostility, and a message that is opposed in every time? When we analyze the message of every single one of the messengers, and the story of every single one of the messengers, from Noah, from Moses, from Jesus, peace be upon them all, and Abraham, every single one of them, we found that they were opposed by individuals who had a problem with their message. Opposed by individuals who had a problem with the fact that there is one true God, who had a problem with the fact that that one true God requires from his creation something very simple and something very easy. A people who inevitably had erected themselves as gods besides Allah, or a people who erected themselves as their own gods, a people who erected themselves as gods that everyone should turn to and worship, or a people who they themselves worship themselves. And it is because of the fact that those concepts which opposed and which serve to be the concepts that oppose the call of every one of the messengers, it is because of the fact that they erected themselves as gods besides Allah that they saw that the message that called to the one true God was a message that has to be fought and destroyed. Because it is a message that inevitably necessitates that call, the call of those who erect themselves as gods besides Allah and as lords besides Allah, that it now has an arch enemy. It now has a message that is beside it that says to the people that there is no true Lord other than your Lord, other than the one that created. And as for those who erect themselves as gods, and as for those who erect themselves as bodies that you should dedicate yourselves to, and that you should dedicate your lives to, then they are without doubt false gods. And one should not dedicate their lives to such things. So for instance, at the time of Noah, peace and blessing be upon him, we found that they were fought, Noah was fought, and his message was fought. At the time of Abraham, we find that he was fought by the likes of Nimrod, who was a king and a ruler at his time, who didn't like the fact that there was an individual that was calling to the fact that no one should be worshipped, and no one should have the dedication of the people other than the one true God. Likewise, at the time of Musa and at the time of Moses, we find that Pharaoh was an individual that fought against Musa and fought against his message, because of the fact that the Pharaoh established himself as a god and established himself as one who the whole of Egypt should dedicate their worship to and should concentrate and focus themselves upon. And because of the fact that Pharaoh established himself as such, we find that the message of Moses was a problem for Pharaoh. The message of Moses, which said that there is no Lord worthy of worship but Allah. The message of Moses, which said and which promoted justice and promoted the removal of oppression and promoted and called the people to worship and called the people to morality and called the people to establishing something from discipline in their lives, it was a message that Fir'aun had a problem with. And that was the case in every single time up until the present day. That we find brothers and sisters in the present day, when someone stands to call to Islam and calls to turn back to the true religion and turn one's attention to that simple message, remembering the fact that we are individuals who are created and have to die and have to stand before our Lord. And if we're created, then therefore any creation has a purpose. Every creation has a purpose. And if every creation has a purpose, there is no doubt that the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one that has created the mountains, the one that has created the pastures that are filled with all types of vegetation, created all of those animals and created the varying birds and the varying aqueous life, that creator, brothers and sisters, has not left the creation alone without explaining to them the purpose of their creation. So when a person turns towards that purpose, and when a person recognizes that fact, and when a person begins to call to that, that message is a message which is fought against by those who erect themselves as gods, or by those who worship themselves. As Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has said in His Quran, have you not seen the one who takes himself and takes his desires to be his God? Have you not seen him? Have you not seen him in your workplace? Have you not seen him on your road? Have you not seen him in the neighborhood? Have you not seen him, brothers and sisters, the one who takes his desires to be his God? The one who cares of nothing other than that which satisfies himself. The one who cares of nothing other than that which pleases him. The one who cares of nothing by way of discipline and morality other than the discipline and morality that is in the realms of his own pleasures. Have you not seen him? Have you not seen the one that establishes himself and his own desires as a God? Therefore we say that the message of Al-Islam is a simple one, that one should worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship Allah the Most High, and that the messenger Muhammad is the final messenger that was sent to mankind, the final messenger after a seal or after a chain of messengers, all of them calling to the same message and all of them warning against the same evils and all of them referring to the same hereafter and all of them pointing to the same God. With that being established, when we analyze, brothers and sisters, the call of those who fight against Islam, we find that without doubt, that which they mention by way of doubts, by way of misconceptions, are doubts and misconceptions which without doubt are petty, and doubts and misconceptions which are constructed for the purpose of turning the people away from that simple message. Concepts such as the fact that Islam subjects the women to oppression and oppresses women. Concepts such as the fact that Islam is a religion that calls to terrorism and the removal of life. Concepts such as the fact that they say Islam is a religion that seeks to remove one's freedom to think and one's freedom in general. Concepts such as the fact that Islam, they say, is a religion that seeks to take the people back to medieval times. And as for ourselves, then we are a people who are developing and we are civilized man. Concepts such as the fact that they say the concept of creation, which is promoted by Islam, is a concept they claim that cannot be proved. Concepts such as the fact that they claim mankind developed from other forms of animal. Concepts that seek to fight against Islam and seek to prove that the message of the messengers is a false one and the message of Al-Islam is a message that cannot be proven. Therefore they say, beginning with the fact that mankind was not created but mankind evolved, they say that if we can prove therefore that mankind merely evolved and was not a creation, that would remove the need for us to believe in a creator. If we can remove the need for us to believe in a creator, then we remove the concept that that creator created for a purpose, which the Muslims they refer to as worship and other than that. Now if we can remove that concept and prove that the world developed scientifically, then there is no need for people to have a need to believe in anything. And if we can establish that, then we can establish freedom of thought and other than that from the concepts that they're trying to promote and trying to establish. So if we can remove the concept of a God, that is the first step to removing the need for any religion or anything from righteousness. And that is the product, and is that concept that is the product of that which we see around us. By way of mankind developing in a unnatural manner and having concepts which oppose the nature of man. So we say, brothers and sisters, that this message is a simple message that we've repeated in a number of sessions. And we have a question concerning the issues that have arisen in this particular time, the likes of September the 11th, and Bin Laden, and Al-Qaeda. A hot issue. Issues such as this arose from time to time, again, for the purpose of establishing that which we've mentioned. Brothers and sisters, the issue of Bin Laden and Al-Qaeda and the call to the removal of terrorism, we believe is a message that we ourselves are honored to be able to say that we began the call to the removal of terrorism. We began the call to the fighting against Bin Laden and Al-Qaeda and all of those who are similar to them. We began that years before September the 11th, and we began that years before anyone heard of Al-Qaeda, and years before anyone received anything from the harms of terrorism here in the West. Al-Islam fights against, brothers and sisters, the likes of that which is established by those who seek to promote that which is known as Kharijiyya. Kharijiyya and the fikr or the ideology of the Khawarij was something that was fought against from the early parts or the early stages in Al-Islam. Kharijiya brothers and sisters was something that developed shortly after the death of the Messenger, when we had a people who arose from amongst the Muslims who claimed that anyone who committed major sins are to be deemed as disbelievers, and that the rulers who rule by other than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed should be fought against and should be killed. Kharijiyya, brothers and sisters, was something that was fought against by the earlier Muslims and the early leaders, beginning with the Sahaba, beginning with the companions of the Messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. The fight against that Kharijiyya continues up until the present time. That we find that the scholars of our Ummah, the scholars of this Muslim nation, have clarified in a number of works and have clarified in a number of lectures and recordings that which will bring light to the fact that this fight against terrorism was something that had begun way before the West even knew what it was, or what this Kharijiyya was, and what it was to receive the harms of terrorism. We say that the likes of Bin Laden and Al-Qaeda, if Al-Qaeda actually exists, and those who resemble them by way of the groups who are upon that thought, we say that the Muslims and the ulama of the Muslimin, the scholars from amongst the Muslimun, have fought against that, as we mentioned in every time, and the callers up until the present day have fought against that. The example of that, an example of that, is the nasiha, or the advice, that was written by the eminent Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Baz to the likes of Bin Laden way before September the 11th, advising him to leave alone that which he is upon by their thought, advising him to leave alone that which he promotes by way of concept, advising him to return back to true Islam, advising him to correct that which he and his followers are upon from misconceptions and from this incorrect and warped understanding. So we say therefore that September the 11th, brothers and sisters, is not something new to the Muslims. We've been receiving the likes of that from the likes of these individuals for many years, and we have fought against that for many years. Although we do say though, and we do fight against though, and we are against those who attempt to utilize that which happened on September the 11th to fight against Islam, that one should strike a difference between al-Islam and this Kharijiyya. We say that this Kharijiyya is something which is not from Islam in any way, and as for Islam, then it does not promote the likes of that which Bin Laden promotes. But as for those who attempt to utilize those actions to claim that al-Islam promotes that and to fight against al-Islam, then our fighting against them is just as we would fight against the likes of Bin Laden and those who call to that which Bin Laden calls to. So we say, brothers and sisters, therefore, that the message of al-Islam is a simple one, and the message of al-Islam is one that is beneficial, brothers and sisters, to each individual, as it is beneficial to each society. A message that promotes morality, a message that promotes discipline, a message that promotes first and foremost, and calls the people first and foremost to worshipping the one God, to worshipping Allah, the Lord of all the worlds. A message that calls the people to that which every single one of the messengers called them to, and that is that they focus their attentions to a reality that is going to come to them. The first of those realities being their own death. That they themselves are individuals who are beings who are to die. And that upon one day, they themselves will cease to exist. That death of theirs will either be a death that is a good one, or it will be an evil death. A good one if one lived a life that would lead to a good death. The life of the believer, the life of one who turns himself to Allah and concentrates upon his Lord, or the life or a death of one who seeks to worship himself and seeks to concentrate his efforts in pleasing himself and leaves alone the belief in his Creator, and leaves alone believing in that which he was created for, that purpose which was the purpose of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Allah alone, and the purpose of following the messenger that was sent to mankind, the messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. On that note, we'll open the floor, brothers and sisters, to questions. If anyone has a question or a query or a qualm, something that needs clarifying, then inshallah we'll take those questions from any of the brothers and sisters. Jazakumullahu khair. Question: what happens if the truth comes to you and you don't? Before I ask it, are there any non-Muslims present? Yeah. Did you have a show of hands? Okay. Question: what happens if the truth comes to you and you don't accept it, and you die upon disbelief? Concerning the question, what happens if the truth comes to you and you don't accept it? We say that every single individual has one of two destinations, as we mentioned. Either that person's destination is a good one or it is an evil one. That destination, brothers and sisters, is not something that is dictated by ourselves, in the sense that we have the ability to determine where a person is going to enter or where a person is going to end up. What we say is that a person, he himself, has with him, by way of his own free will and by way of the ability to follow right or wrong, and has his own destiny, if you like, in his own hands. And when we say that his destiny is in his own hands, we're saying that a person's destiny, and that a person's hereafter, or a person's conclusion in the hereafter and his final abode, lies upon his own actions and upon his own belief. If a person believes first and foremost in the one true God and believes in the message that was sent by every single one, or that was brought by every single one of the messengers, that message being a simple one, as we've mentioned: worship your Creator, that you were created for a purpose, that if somebody was to create something or was to make something, and that creation was then to act in a way opposite to the manner in which it had been created, the one who created that would have the option to do with that creation as he will. If he willed or she willed, he could destroy it. If he willed, he could burn it. If he willed, he could stamp on it and crush it. Yeah, and that is all of that returns back to the free will, or the decision of the one who created that thing. And we say likewise that Allah the Most High, Allah the Creator of the heavens and the earth, has conveyed to mankind the purpose of him creating them, and likewise their destination, which is one of two, if they themselves act upon their own free will, which Allah himself has given to them, in one of those two ways. If they act upon their own free will and believe in Allah and follow that which Allah has prescribed, يعني, that which Allah has prescribed, if it is followed, it would lead them to good, then their result is one that is good. And if one follows that which Allah has mentioned will lead to evil, and will lead to an evil destination in the hereafter, then one's result therefore, and one's final abode, will be an evil one. And we ask Allah that he makes all of us have that abode which is a pleasing abode, and that abode which is far from an evil one. So we say therefore, if the truth comes to an individual, and hopefully that answered the question, that we believe that the truth is embodied in the message of the messengers, If that message is rejected, then there is no possible way that a person can conclude or can have a result that is a good one. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Most High, is the one in whose hands is the good or the bad result. And if Allah has dictated and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has determined that the one who does such and such a thing, I will place upon him an evil end, then that is something that Allah the Most High has determined and Allah has decreed, and it is not for us to speak against that which Allah the Most High has determined and decreed. Rather, it is merely for us to convey the statement of our Lord and leave mankind to act in regards to those statements in a manner that he himself sees fit. And as Allah the Most High has said, لا يسأل أما يفعل لا يسأل أما يفعل ما يفعل وهم يسألون. As Allah has said, that he will not be asked, he will not be questioned. Allah the Most High will not be questioned concerning that which he does, for they, meaning creation, will be questioned. So we say therefore that the call is that mankind corrects himself before he has to stand before his Lord the Most High. Question, what is shirk? And could you give an explanation of this, please? Concerning the concept of shirk, shirk, brothers and sisters, is to ascribe a partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to ascribe a partner to Allah the Most High, either in Allah's lordship, yani to claim that Allah, that there is a Lord besides Allah. And when we say lordship and we refer to lordship, we're referring to a number of things. We're referring to Allah's ability to create, referring to Allah's ability to maintain and arrange his creation, and likewise we're referring to the fact that Allah possesses the whole of the creation, and that the whole of the creation and the whole of the heavens and the earth is the possession of Allah the Most High. So when we say Allah is the Lord, we're referring primarily to these concepts. So if someone ascribes a partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and claims that someone created alongside Allah, or claims that someone owns a portion of the creation alongside Allah, or that someone arranges the affairs of the creation alongside Allah, we say that he has committed, referring primarily to these concepts. So if someone ascribes a partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and claims that someone created alongside Allah, or claims that someone owns a portion of the creation alongside Allah, or that someone arranges the affairs of the creation alongside Allah, we say that he has committed shirk, or he has ascribed a partner to Allah in the issues of Allah's lordship, in that which relates to Allah's lordship. Likewise, in the names and the attributes of Allah, that Allah the Most High has names and attributes that are specific to him and that are befitting to his majesty, the likes of Ar-Rahman, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ar-Rahman, the most beneficent, the mercy giver, Ar-Rahim, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Wahhab, the one that bestows bounties, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Wudud, the loving, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or Allah the Most High, is Al-Azim, the great, Al-Aziz, the mighty, and other than that, from the noble names that Allah has given to himself, that if a person seeks to claim that that name which is specific to Allah, that he shares in Allah, he shares with Allah in that name, that that person has committed shirk, or has ascribed himself as a partner with Allah in regards to his names and attributes. Likewise, in regards to the issues of ibadah and the issues of worship, in the issues of worship, we say that the worship, anything that is considered an act of worship, is to be directed solely to Allah the Most High. It is to be given to Allah alone, and no one from creation should have a portion of that. So supplication, prostration, prayer, slaughtering, yani religious sacrifice, vowing, oaths, other than that, all of those things which are considered to be acts of worship, fasting, making pilgrimage, that all of those acts of worship are done and carried out and performed for the sake of Allah alone. And if a person performs an aspect from those aspects of worship, then we say that a person has committed shirk. Shirk, brothers and sisters, is the greatest of all of the evil deeds, the most evil of all evil actions. And it is the one deed that Allah the Most High will never forgive. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرْ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. As Allah has said, indeed, Allah will never forgive that a person makes shirk with Him. Allah will never forgive that a person ascribes a partner to Him. But Allah will forgive whomsoever He wills, or He will forgive sins which are lesser than that to whosoever He wills. So we say that the call, first and foremost, the primary call of the Muslim is to call the people to Tawheed, to singling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out in those aspects of worship, to singling Allah out in the affairs of Lordship, and to singling Allah out in the affairs of His names and His attributes that are solely to Him and that belong to Him alone. And we say that the person who commits the major and the largest sin is the person that ascribes a partner to Allah the Most High. And that is the first and major sin. And that is something which is not only present in the Quran, but is even present in the Bible. And we find that present in the Old Testament. The first commandment was, "Hear, O Israel, your God is one God. You shall not make any graven images of anything that walks in the sea, or flies in the sky, or walks upon the or walks upon the land, swims in the sea, flies in the sky, or walks upon the land." So that issue, and that primary issue of Tawheed, worshipping Allah alone and staying away from ascribing a partner to Allah, is a concept that was the primary call of every single one of the messengers. And we say that this is one of the major areas where we believe the Christians have gone astray, that they have devoted aspects of their worship to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have devoted their supplication, some of them their prostration, to the likes of Jesus, peace and blessings be upon him, who we believe was a messenger and was from the most noble of all of the messengers, who we believe came to establish the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be worshipped and that he was the messenger to be followed. But we believe likewise that Jesus himself prayed, that Jesus himself worshipped, that Jesus himself fell upon his face in prostration and did other than that from fasting and the different types of worship. So we say that that worship that was committed, that was performed by Jesus, was performed to someone higher than Jesus, to someone that Jesus called to, and to someone that Jesus never ever claimed in the Bible to be. And that is Allah, the Lord Most High. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we believe that shirk is the most severe of all of the sins. And that is why we say that a person may believe or may say to himself, "Well, I believe in the one God and I don't commit shirk." But we would ask one to question oneself concerning that statement, that a person, first and foremost, who believes in the one God, as we've mentioned, understands that if that one God created, then he has a purpose for his creation, and that is to worship. How much of one's life does one devote to that worship? How much of your life do you devote to carrying out your purpose, the purpose that you were created for? How much of your life have you devoted to disciplining yourself for the sake of Allah, to doing something not because you wanted to do it, but because it was pleasing to your Lord, and it was something that led to your Lord's good pleasure. How many days have you spent, or how many hours have you spent devoting those hours to that which pleases your Creator? And likewise, how free are you from shirk? How free are you from keeping away and staying away from ascribing partners to Allah? And we already mentioned the verse in the book of Allah where Allah asks and poses the question, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, have you not seen the one that takes his desires to be his God? Are you from those who take their desires to be their God? Are you from those individuals who ascribe a partner with Allah, that partner being your own desires, dedicating your life to that, dedicating your life to pleasing that, dedicating your life to carrying out that which you yourself desire? How much of your life, brothers and sisters, have you dedicated to the one that created you and the one that does not cease to sustain you and give you life and bless you with wealth? Question, can you explain the seriousness of the religion in regards to death and in regards to the Day of Judgment and preparing for that? Concerning death, brothers and sisters, there is no doubt that the issue of death, the reality of death, is something that no two human beings will argue or will dispute about. That every single one of us, no matter where we're from, no matter what background we're from, and no matter how high in the how high we are in regards to possessing material wealth and possessing other than that, from nobility or having rank or having position, every single one of us, brothers and sisters, will without doubt have to taste death, as Allah has explained to us in His Quran, كل نفس ذائقة الموت, that every single soul will taste death. There is not an individual that walks upon the face of the earth except that within 150 or so years will cease to exist. Everyone that is present now, if we were to look, maybe even less than that, 120 years, maybe even 100 years, I'm sure that there will be very few of the people who are walking upon the earth now. Very few of those individuals will continue to exist. Many of us within the next 20 years may die. Many of us within the next 5 years may die. And many of us within the coming months may find ourselves likewise ceasing to exist. So that death and that reality, brothers and sisters, is something which every single one of us needs to remove from the back of our minds and place at the forefronts of our minds, and reflect upon the fact that we are weak individuals, created from flesh and bone, created from clay, originally and existing from flesh and bone, individuals that become sick, individuals that become ill, individuals who are taken by different types of diseases, and individuals who will eventually die. There is one day, brothers and sisters, that each and every one of you will be seeing his last sight and will be taking his last breath, looking at the world for the last time and preparing to enter into another world, looking at his children for the last time, looking at his or her relatives for the last time, bidding one's relatives and one's friends farewell, bidding life farewell, and preparing to die, preparing to enter into that state where one's body begins to decay, preparing to enter into that state where one's body is entered into a coffin and shrouded and descended into the earth alone, without anyone to accompany you, without anyone to give you or to console you, without anyone to help you and aid you, alone, under the ground, alone. So we say that that reality, brothers and sisters, is a reality that every single one of us has to prepare for, Muslims and non-Muslims alike. That every single one of us has to face that day. After that day, brothers and sisters, there is another serious day. And that other day is the day which is referred to as Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of reckoning, the day of judgment. That day, brothers and sisters, that those individuals who are dead under the earth, and those individuals who are in their graves from the time of the creation of the first man up until the time that the last man dies, every single individual that walked upon the earth will be brought forward by Allah. And a day that is referred to and is given a number of names in the Quran because of its severity. Allah refers to it occasionally as the day of noise and clamor. Allah occasionally refers to it as the day of reckoning. Allah occasionally refers to it as the day of regret. Allah occasionally refers to it as the day that the sara'ir, that the secrets will all be brought forth. The day that everything that was obscure will be made clear to every single individual, and the day that you will have to give account for every single action that you committed. A day that is a reality, and a day that every single one of the messengers called to. And a day that without doubt every one of us has to prepare for. If we know, for instance, that there is a day, if we were students, there is a day that is coming close, that we have to sit an exam, and that we have to take a test. There is no doubt that the sensible student, the student who has half an intellect, will begin to prepare for that day. Prepare for the day that they have to take a test, the questions of which one is ignorant of. The questions that are present on that test paper, a person has no idea what they are. A day that is coming that a person's knowledge and studying will be tested. If a person knew that a day like that was coming, an examination day, there is no doubt that he would prepare for that day. He would revise, he would look over his work, he would memorize, he would go over that which he was not too clear about, he would go to the library, he would research, he would take time out, he would sacrifice going out maybe some weekends, sacrifice going clubbing, he would sacrifice aspects of his life to make sure that the day of the examination that he passes, and hopefully that he passes with flying colors. So what is the case of the one that has a day that he would be examined, the conclusion of that examination, if it is good, if it is everlasting bliss, and if it is evil, then it is everlasting torment. What is the reality of a person, and what is the state of an individual that takes and pays no attention to that day? What is the reality of an individual that pays no concern to such a day? A day that is described by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as being يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِي. The day that a person will flee from his brother, وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ, and will flee likewise from his mother and from his father, وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِي, and he will flee likewise from his wife, and he will flee from his children. Why? Because he didn't love them, no. Because he didn't care for them, no. Because on that day, as Allah explains, no one will have a concern other than the salvation of himself. No one will have a concern other than freeing himself from a torment that awaits those who did those things or committed those deeds, which Allah has explained, the one who commits them deserve such a torment. يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبي وصاحبته وبني. Every individual on that day will be concerned with himself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likewise mentions that the day when the sakha comes, he refers to it as the day that the excruciating or the extreme tremendous noise is heard. The noise that is the sounding of the trumpet that will begin that day, a sounding which will lead to every individual that exists upon the earth dying. That sounding will be sounded again, and upon the second sounding, every individual that was dead and every individual that is under the earth, those who had died previously, whether they had died recently or centuries ago or many millions of years ago, all of them upon the second sounding will be brought back, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, أَلَا يَظُنُّ أُولَٰئِكَ أَنَّهُمْ مَبْعُوثُونَ. Do these individuals, referring to those who do wrong, or referring to those who transgress against the boundaries of Allah, do these individuals, أَلَا يَظُنُّ أُولَٰئِكَ أَنَّهُمْ مَبْعُوثُونَ, do those individuals not believe that they will be brought forth? لِيَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ, for a great day. يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, the day that people and mankind will have to stand before the Lord of all the worlds. That day that each and every one of you will be questioned for everything big and small. Allah likewise clarifies in the book of Allah that when a man receives his deed scroll, he will say, what is it with this deed scroll that it does not leave anything small or large? Nothing minute was left. Every little thing that was done by an individual, every single thing will be mentioned on that deed scroll and will be brought forth, that a person may be reckoned for those deeds in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah likewise mentions, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ, and as for those individuals, Allah mentions likewise, وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُ, as Allah mentions, وَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُ, as for those individuals whose deeds and whose mizan, whose scales are heavy because of the fact that their deed scroll is heavy, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, then these are the ones who are the successful ones. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُ, and as for those whose deed scales and the scales are light, فَأُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ, these are the ones who transgressed against themselves, and these are the ones who will receive the torment, brothers and sisters, and will be punished by Allah. It is not my statement. Neither is it the statement of the messenger. Neither is it the statement of any one of the messengers. Rather, this is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, بَلَاغ فَهَلْ يُهْلَكُ إِلَّا الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقُونَ, that Allah mentions, بَلَاغ, this is nothing but a بَلَاغ. This is nothing but a message that is conveyed. And is anyone destroyed except those who do wrong? And likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, مَا عَلَى الرَّسُولِ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغِ, there is nothing upon the messenger except to convey. So every single one of the messengers that were sent for the purpose of conveying. Not for establishing a concept or creating a religion, not for bringing about principles from themselves, rather to merely convey that which the Lord of all the worlds has commissioned him to convey. And likewise, the believers in every time, that is their message and that is their mission, that they convey that which Allah has conveyed to us by way of his messenger, peace and blessings be upon him, in his book, and that which was brought to us by every single one of the messengers, merely to convey that message, and that you yourselves act upon that message. Not merely that you convey that, but you yourselves act upon it and to convey it to anyone who has a heart. And that heart, brothers and sisters, when we say anyone who has a heart, that heart that Allah mentions throughout the Quran and mentions on that day, on the day of judgment, Allah mentions that the successful ones are those who come to Allah biqalbin salim, who come to Allah with a sound heart. That Allah mentions in the Book of Allah, and He mentions on a number of occasions, that which revolves around the state of affairs and the condition of a person's heart. Why? That is because, brothers and sisters, the heart is the origin, the heart is the place in the body of that individual that would allow him to accept truth because of its sound nature, or will lead him to reject truth because of its corrupt nature. If one's heart is corrupt, and one's heart is in out of its place, and is not sound, then no matter what a person receives by way of teaching, and by way of advice, and by way of calling to the true message, if one's heart is corrupt, and if one's heart has left its true nature, then that message will be rejected by that heart. And if the heart rejects the message, then the ears will not hear, neither will the eyes see that which is clear to anyone who has eyes to see. So we say therefore that the origin of the acceptance of this message begins with the heart of mankind. And as the Messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, mentioned, أَلَا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُدْغَةٌ إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. Indeed, in the body there is a morsel. If it is sound, then the whole of the body is sound. And if it is corrupt, then the whole of the body is corrupt. Indeed, that morsel is the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, after mentioning that He placed in mankind, after mentioning that He created him and gave him a heart, likewise that He created mankind with aql, that He created mankind with intellect, gave him the ability to think, gave him the ability to see and look above that which is given to him by way of concepts and principles, and to analyze them and to scrutinize them. Gave him the ability to think and use his brain, and not be subjected to the brainwashing that takes place in every society and every time. Rather that he is an individual that thinks and uses his brain. So Allah blesses him with, first and foremost, a heart. A heart by which he thinks with, a heart with which he perceives. Likewise, He blesses him with an intellect, which has a connection to the heart. Likewise, He blesses him by placing in him that which is known as a fitrah. A fitrah, which the scholars have explained, is the natural inclining towards good, and the natural recognition towards that which is truth, and the natural inclination towards that which is righteous. So Allah has given one a heart, given him intellect, placed in him that fitrah, that natural inclination towards good, and on top of that, Allah has sent messengers in every time, calling to that which one's heart will recognize, calling to that which one's intellect will not reject, calling to that which one's fitrah, one's natural inclination will incline towards. And likewise, Allah has placed in and around the creation that which will increase all of that, and that which will increase a person in recognizing that all of those things are true. From signs in creation, from differing forms of animals. And I'm sure, as we mentioned, I'm sure you've watched all those wildlife programs with all those amazing creatures. And there are people who want us to believe that all of that just evolved, that all of that came from nowhere, that all of that doesn't have any origin in any creator. Rather that it merely evolved from water, and then eventually they became reptiles, and evolved and became something else, and now we have this magnificent creation around us, and these magnificent life forms, all of them coming from no creator, but just evolving from nothing. Brothers and sisters, I know, as we mentioned, and I believe that you're people who respect knowledge and respect yourselves, and have the ability to analyze, and the ability to use that which Allah has given you by way of a heart, and by way of an intellect, and by way of a fitrah and a natural inclination towards truth when you hear it, and a natural inclination towards the messenger, towards the message of every single one of the messengers. And for that reason, Allah in His mercy sent the messengers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to His creation that book, as He revealed books before time, which is or has in it and is embodied with truth and embodied with that which every single individual who has a heart and has an intellect will read and reflect and recognize to be the truth. And recognizing all of that to be the truth is not sufficient, rather it is a must that anyone who recognizes something to be true acts upon that which he recognizes to be the truth. So we say, brothers and sisters, that the realities of death and the realities of the final day was a reality that was called to by every single one of the messengers, and we continue that call in this particular time, even though the media and even though materialism and the demigods of materialism will want us to believe that these concepts and these beliefs and these truths and these facts are nothing but merely concepts and nothing but things which, you know, people of old, as Allah has mentioned in the Quran, asatirul awwaleen, the disbelievers in every time, they used to say when they heard the message of the messenger, asatirul awwaleen, tales of the old, tales of the old. This is what we're expected to believe, brothers and sisters, in this particular time. Some people say that it's very boastful for a Muslim to say, I am upon the truth, and there's so much other religions in the world. And we say therefore that all of those other religions, there is no doubt that if there are other religions, and there are without doubt, that those religions need to be scrutinized. What scrutinized by way of that which they possess from truth, and that which they possess from falsehood, and that which they possess by way of calling to the reality that every single one of the messengers called to, or their distance from that. We say without doubt that the lights of the Abrahamic faith, the lights of Christianity, the lights of Judaism, without doubt have their origin in the message that was sent to creation and sent to mankind from Allah the Most High. And we believe that Christianity and that Judaism, at one stage, at one time, the message of those religions was a message that was a pure message, similar to the message of Islam in this particular time. But we say though that those messages were perverted and those messages were changed a long time, throughout time. So for instance, the pure message of Jesus, which was to worship one God and which was to follow His example, was perverted till we find in this particular time that the Christians now, they worship Jesus when Jesus Himself never worshipped or never called to the worship of Himself. Rather, Jesus Himself worshipped. And we find that the Christians likewise in this time call to the fact that, or call to that which they claim to be a fact, that God came to creation and was sent to creation, or sent His only begotten Son to creation, that He may take the sin of mankind. And that was based upon the love that Allah had for His world and for His creation, that He sent His Son to die for the whole of mankind. A concept which we believe is a false concept. A concept which we believe not only does it have in it, as we've mentioned, the concept of shirk, ascribing a partner to Allah, because those who hold that concept, they say that Jesus is a part of God. Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, these three are one, they say. That Jesus is a part of God. And that Jesus had a share in the creation. And if we were to ask the simple question, if we were to analyze and look around the creation, the Christian, do you believe that Jesus, who was sent as a messenger, created the mountains and the bees and the birds and the trees, and other than that, from the glorious creation that we see around us, do we believe, or does one believe, that all of that was created by Jesus? You would be hard pushed to hear a yes. Very few of them will reply with a yes. Therefore we say that Jesus was a messenger that was sent to mankind, just as Moses was a messenger, and just as Abraham was a messenger, and the fact that Jesus was born of a miraculous birth, which we believe in, does not mean and does not necessitate that he is the Son of God. Because Jesus was born without a father, that does not now necessitate that God was and that Allah is the father of Jesus. Because if that is the case, just as Allah has said in the Quran, إِنَّ مَثَلِ عِيسَى عِنَّ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمٍ خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. That indeed the example of Jesus with Allah is as the example of Adam. He was created from dirt, and then it was said to him, be, and he was. If the fact that Jesus was born miraculously, if that is all that it takes for us to deem Jesus the Son of God, then Adam has more right to be referred to as the Son of God, and has more right to be referred to as a part of God, and to be added to that Trinity. But we say Allah is far removed from having need of a partner, and Allah is far removed from having need of a son. And we say likewise that Jesus would never have called the people to worship himself as he himself worshipped other than himself. And Jesus would never have called to the fact that he was part of God. Rather, we believe and we understand, for the one who studies that which has taken place with the Bible, that this is from the concept that has been added to the Bible over the years, and this is something that has been declared a fact by some of the major clergymen in the church, that the Bible itself has been changed, and certain concepts that Christianity revolved around had been added to the Bible. As you know, there are over 48 different versions of the Bible, and all of those Bibles having with them issues removed, and having in them issues added and changed. Likewise, Judaism, we believe, is a religion that has its origin in the message of Moses, but we believe likewise that the message of Moses has been perverted by the books that were added to the Torah, or the book that was given to Moses, the likes of the Talmud, and other than that which the Jews ascribe to. And likewise, we find that Judaism has in it a rejection of a number of messengers. From those messengers, we find that Judaism has in it a rejection of Jesus, and likewise it has in it a rejection of the messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. So we say therefore that Judaism, for the one who is a Jew, at the time of the coming of Jesus, if you were to reject Jesus, claiming to be a Jew, at the time of Jesus, then your faith is worthless. That your rejection of the messenger that was sent by Allah, after him sending a messenger, you rejecting that messenger would now necessitate that you are no longer a believer in Allah and his messengers. Rather, you are a rejecter of Allah and his messengers. Because to accept Allah and his messengers is to accept the messenger with his message. And anyone who rejects Jesus inevitably rejects the message that Jesus came with. And likewise, those who reject the messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, inevitably reject the message that the messenger Muhammad came with. Therefore, the one who rejects the message of any one of the messengers could not be deemed a believer. Just as if a Muslim claimed to be a rejecter, to be a Muslim, but he rejects Jesus, our belief is that that person is not a Muslim. Or if he rejects Abraham, our belief is that that person is not a Muslim. Likewise, the believers at the time of Moses, and those who followed the religion of Moses before Jesus came, with the coming of Jesus, and with the coming of the message of Jesus, if they rejected the message of Jesus after the coming of Jesus, after Jesus came with the Injil and came with the New Testament, the Injil, which is referred to as the New Testament, although the New Testament is greatly different from the Injil, if one was to reject that, then a person's rejection of Jesus and the message that he came with would be a rejection of faith. And all of the other religions likewise, brothers and sisters, inevitably for us to discuss and deal with that, that would require a whole lecture in and of itself to discuss the problems that occur in the other religions and that which is present in the other religions from opposing the true message of every one of the messengers. But if we were to analyze and to scrutinize those religions, we would see that those religions have in them primarily an opposition to the oneness or to the worship of the one God. And likewise, most of them have in that, or all of them have in them, a call to shirk, a call to ascribing a partner to Allah. And likewise, many of them have in them a rejection of the messengers. And most of the religions have in them the erection of gods besides Allah, whether those gods be idols, whether those gods be aspects of creation, the sun, the moon, or certain types of animals, or even the worship of messengers. Just the same way that we speak against the one who worships Jesus, we speak against the one who worships Muhammad. And we say that the one who believes that it is okay for him to worship Muhammad is a disbeliever and is not a Muslim. So that should be understood, brothers and sisters, concerning our claim and concerning the fact that Islam is the one true message that continues to exist until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes his earth. Why is it that men and women should be segregated? We believe, brothers and sisters, concerning the separation of men and women, that al-Islam is a religion that seeks to cut all evils and cut all evils from their root. And that we do not promote, as people say, we find some people saying, well, why do you have to cover, you know, why shouldn't you be disciplined enough, you know, to not look at women, or not to fornicate, or not to commit adultery? Shouldn't you be strong enough within yourselves? One may argue and say, well, yes, one should be, but the reality of which is good, that a person desires to marry, and that a person goes about that marriage and goes about marrying in the correct way, and that a person marries for the purpose of removing from himself the carrying out of evil and lewd actions and encouraging chastity for himself, then we believe that that's a good thing. And that desire to marry is something which is good. But if someone is attracted to the opposite sex because of something that he has seen from that person, or something that she has seen from him by way of looks, or by way of yani body part, or by way of something that connects to one's beauty, or that they've been alone and they've spoken and that's the speech of that individual attracts them, and then they lead to illicit, or that leads to illicit sexual practice, that a person sleeps with a man's wife, or that a woman sleeps with the husband of another, or that there is sex outside of marriage, that which is known as fornication, that we say that those affairs are evil affairs that al-Islam seeks to remove and cut from the root. And the root of those affairs, without doubt, begins, as we all know, with a glance. And that glance leads to recognizing the eyes and being attracted to the eyes and to the smile. And after being attracted to the smile, one's attracted to that personality. After being attracted to the personality, one likes his or her sense of humor. Then one is attracted to a certain aspect of that person's anatomy. And then one is attracted to the way he speaks or the way she speaks. The desire and that attraction grows, and one desires to be alone with that individual, maybe gets on the blower to them, speaks to them for a period, and then we know, brothers and sisters, what comes from that by way of sexual malpractice, and other than that, from the things which any righteous individual will distance himself from. Therefore we say that there is a principle in al-Islam, and that is that al-Islam seeks to make that which is known as sadd al-dhara'i'. Sadd al-dhara'i'. Sadd al-dhara'i'. Meaning cutting the means to an evil. Cutting the means to an evil. for instance, statues and ornaments are something which the Muslim is not permitted to have and to possess. From the reasons that it is not permitted, from the reasons, as the scholars have highlighted, is that it was statues and ornaments that led the people of Noah to start worshipping statues of individuals who were known to be righteous individuals. They were people of righteousness at a particular time, at the time of Noah. Those men of righteousness, after they died, the people of that time erected statues in remembrance of those individuals and of the righteous and the holy nature of those people. After a time passed and after a certain generation of people passed, the people started to see how those statues were being glorified by the people, and they were eventually worshipped besides Allah. Those statues were worshipped and they became gods in and of themselves. For that reason, the scholars, they mentioned that this is from the reasons that Islam prohibits having statues. That although a person may recognize what this statue is, and may recognize that it's not Allah and that it's not God, who is to tell what one's offspring may believe concerning that? One's offsprings may believe that mum or dad used to gain something from good fortune from that. So he may turn his aspects of his worship towards that statue, thereby committing the major sin of shirk that we mentioned and that we clarified earlier on. So we said that Islam seeks to cut the evils from their roots, and by doing that, and from doing that, and from the things which it seeks to cut, is the evils of fornication, the evils of adultery, and those evils which are connected to illicit and illegal sexual practice. And that begins with both sexes being attracted to each other. So we say therefore that the man adorns himself in an attire that covers that which is befitting for him to cover from his body, and likewise that the women adorn themselves in that which protects them from the naked eye and protects them from the eye of those who have evils in their hearts. And we know, brothers and sisters, that the vast majority of rape cases that have taken place because some evil individual, or someone with a sick heart, was attracted to a woman that he saw. If he saw a certain aspect of a woman, maybe she was wearing a mini, or she was wearing certain garments, him with his sick nature was attracted to that, and it was too strong for him. His desire and his attraction towards that was too strong for him, to fight against. So much so that it led him to attack that woman and to take from her that which he had seen or that which he had desired. So we say therefore that Islam seeks to cut many evils other than the evils of fornication from the root, and it does that by the likes of these affairs, segregation, and those things which cut these evils from the root. And on that note, brothers and sisters, we have to round up because we've run out of time, and we thank all of the brothers and sisters for attending, and we hope that no one has been offended by anything that they've heard from the brothers and sisters, from the people who have come who are non-Muslims, and we hope that it's at least started the ball rolling for them to begin researching into Al-Islam. And as we mentioned, the sitting is going to be present every second Sunday, so the Sunday after the sitting will continue by someone other than myself, from the good brothers, inshallah, who are equipped to continue conveying the message. And once again, brothers and sisters, we thank you for attending, and we ask that Allah guides all of us to that which Allah loves. Wallahu a'lam, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammad.